Dude, I was trying to explain. I was trying to tell the story like you told the story to me last night to Emily. And I just wish that she would have heard you tell it. It was so great. Oh, it was so good. The Divines are getting a puppy.
Dude, I'm actually more excited about it today than I was.
You are?
Yeah. Did I tell you that I was waking up with anxiety in the night because of it?
Oh, my God.
No. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't sleep because of it. I was freaking out. Yeah. Because all of the power was taken out of my hands and given to my children, basically. One of them specifically. One of them. It was all removed. I was... And the interesting thing is I didn't even tell Lisa that I was going through this, having this anxiety. So just the other night, I couldn't sleep until like 1:30, 2 in the morning.
Oh, my God.
Couldn't sleep. Then I woke up early and then I was freaking out. And then I was like, oh, no. I was like on the internet. And I was like searching for other dogs. I was like, ah! And I was like coming up with all of these elaborate things of like how I was going to, like, I'm just going to find another dog. I'm just going to drive. I'm just going to get a dog. I'm just going to come home. I'm just going to be like,
with a dog?
Look, I've got a dog.
Wait a minute.
And the kids are going to be like, that doesn't look like the dog. I'm like, what? It grew. So, yeah. So it was a whole thing. If anybody's wondering what the hell I'm talking about, we are getting a dog in the Divine household. New dog's coming.
And new dog's coming.
I made a... I made a mistake that I might be paying for 15 years. It was a life lesson that I'll probably never get to. It might not never happen again. So although it was a life lesson, I'm never going to be able to, sort of like capitalize on the lesson. What happened is that we were going to be going away. We were going to be going away to Australia. And because of that, we were going to be going for 6 weeks. It was going to be a working holiday. And because of that, we were holding off getting a dog. So my daughter and my son have wanted a dog for like the best part of a year since we lost Georgie, Big George.
Oh, so George.
Yeah, we lost George over a year ago now. And my kids have been begging for a dog. And I've been saying, hey, look, we're going to Australia for 6 weeks. It's not fair. I can't take... You know, can't take a puppy to granddad and say, here you go, dad. See you in 6 weeks. Good luck. So I said to the kids, look, we're going to have to wait. Anyway, so I damaged my shoulder about 6 months ago. Long story short, there's two bones. They're not where they're supposed to be.
they're not making contact.
Yes, they're not. Yes, I've damaged my shoulder. And they're not where they're supposed to be. That was about 6 months ago, and I thought it was going to fix itself. It hasn't fixed itself, so I had to go to hospital and get this. All this stuff happened. Anyway, all that to say that we had to postpone the trip to Australia. I said to Lisa, I was like, look, I can't go to Australia for 6 weeks and not be able to swim in the sea and not be able to do the bodyboarding, the surfing thing, like nothing. I'll be there with my little crappy arm, you know. So I was like, look, let's push it out until autumn next year. And instantly she was like, oh, we should get a dog then. I was like, yeah, we should get a dog, thinking we'll look at a later date, like maybe in a week or so, or maybe after Christmas.
Yeah, like start the process of looking for the dog, right? Like, yeah, we're going to start this process now.
And then, and then a day later, a text comes through. And the text is just a link to some puppies. Well, I look at the puppies, and I'm like, yep, they're puppies. So I like message Lisa back. I was like, oh, they're super cute. Yeah, wicked. I'll see you when I get home. Anyway, so I get home, and... Lisa's like, oh, I've booked to go and see the puppies. We're going to go see the puppies. I was like, okay. And I've got a lot on. I'm like, and I can remember I was flustered at the time. I'm like cleaning. If anybody's wondering, I am Mr. Clean, by the way.
Ian
and I were talking about the other day. I'm sort of like going round. I'm like, I'm moving stuff.
You're tidying up.
Exactly. I'm tidying stuff.
You're unloading that dishwasher.
I'm unloading the dishwasher. I'm doing all of that stuff. And I'm not thinking. If I'd thought this through, it would have rolled out a different way. I would have said, hey, Lisa, let me go. I'll check out the puppies. If you really want me to go check out these puppies, I'll go on my own. I'll do the due diligence. And if it looks good, hey, you and the kids can come along. We'll meet the puppies. We'll do that whole thing. So That's what I would have done. But I'm flustered and I'm like cleaning and I'm like tidying. I'm doing that whole thing, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And then Lisa's like, oh, we've got to set off. We've got to go see the puppies. And I was like, oh, shit. And I'm flustered. I'm like, oh, yeah. Okay. Everybody get in the car. Let's go. So we bundle them all into the car. The kids, we set off, drive to this place. I get out the car. We walk into the house. And as I walk into the house, I have this oh shit moment. I was like, oh shit, I brought the kids to look at puppies. This is without me being here, like without me even checking anything. I'm like, and then at that very moment, that realization of we shouldn't have the kids with us, this like ugly little bat ran towards me, snorting. I was like, oh, I look down at this dog, and I'm like, oh, we're not getting one of these. Like, we're not getting one of these. Confidence, you know, was high at that moment. I was like, we're not getting one of these.
Yeah.
Anyway, within sort of like 15 minutes, my kids are in the puppies. They're basically bathing in the puppies. They're like,
I love it.
Puppies, they're just like rolling around with all the puppies and stuff. And I'm like looking at all these puppies. There's like maybe like 8 or 9 of them there. And I look at in the corner, and I'm like, and there's like this, I guess sort of like a runt, right? Like the runt of the litter is in the corner, and it's like smaller than the rest and hellishly more ugly than the rest. And the others were ugly. Let me just put it out there, right?
What kind of dog are we talking about here? What kind of dogs are these?
Bat. Ugly bat. No, it's a Boston Terrier, right?
Bat dogs.
Ugly bat. It's like, yes.
But didn't you guys want a Boston Terrier? I thought that was the whole thing.
But they do come in different shapes and sizes, too. Like, lots of different shapes and sizes. And I've only learned this after the fact, that they come in. There's different weights of Boston Terrier, different height. All of these different things, right?
Of course.
Mother looked like a loaf of bread with legs and a vampire-faced bat. Like, that's what it looked like, right? You know, when you look at the face of a vampire bat, and you're like, boy, that's an ugly... So it's like a loaf of bread with a vampire face bat. A vampire bat face.
Oh.
And I look in the corner and there's this like this little runt, and I'm like, oh, and it was uglier than the rest. And I said to the woman, have you got any bitches? Because my kids and my wife really were, we've had lots of dogs. There's been a lot of wieners, a lot of schlongs. It's been a sausage party.
Hold on. This shall not pass. Hold on. In the UK, hold on. Do you actually use ye old term bitches for female dog? Do you actually use that? Like it's common, like that's what people say?
Do you not call them bitches?
No. I mean, we know that that's what they called them in the olden days, dude.
What?
In the olden days.
No, dude.
That like is every a, kid in the UK, grows it's up like, on the schoolyard.
Is it a dog or a bitch?
No. Is it a dog? Is it a guy dog or a lady dog? Is it a boy or a girl? Everybody grows up on the playground knowing that bitch means female dog. Like, you learn that in the second grade, but then you don't use it for that anymore.
I think we do in the UK. Maybe this is another I think you do. Is it a bitch?
I think it is.
I'm like running this in my mind. I can imagine saying to somebody, oh, is it a bitch? And they'd be like, yeah, it's a bitch. No, it's a dog. It's a bitch or a dog. Yeah.
Dude, you said that to me last night when you were telling me this story. And I was like, ding, like it pinged me, you know? I'm like, oh, you know, like just how you guys just casually throw the C word around and it's all good. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like in the States, that doesn't fly. And this dog shit would not fly. And I love it. And I'm here for it. And I'm not trying to change you. I just wanted to clarify. That's incredible. It's incredible.
Bitch.
Oh my God.
I think I'm 99.9% sure that that is the thing in the UK. It's like dog or bitch. Anyway,
listen, our audience is going to let us know. Guys, let us know. Is please, that a thing? Yeah. Is that a thing where you live? Oh, I love it. Anyway, carry on. I just couldn't let it go. I'll never let it go.
Anyway, I am like, yeah, please let us know in the comments, dog or bitch. Is that? I know that you're like, oh, yeah, it's like a totally normal thing to say in the UK.
Oh, and, it's amazing.
So I look at this woman and I say, oh, yeah, we were looking for a bitch. And
incredible.
And she's like, oh, yeah, well, we've got two. She's like, this is one here. This one's already taken, though. I was like, oh, okay. And at this point, I'm like, we're not going to get one of these dogs anyway.
Yeah.
You know, we're not getting one of these dogs anyway. So I'm looking around and the woman points over in the corner and she's like, oh, and that's the other one over there.
Oh, no.
And she said, yes. And she's available. I was like,
yeah, she is. The ugliest one is always available.
Yeah. And I swear to God, this is what I said. I was like, oh, I was like, it's that one's nose is pushed in more than the rest, right? And she says to me, she says, yeah, I'm hoping a nose comes out a little bit. And I was like, oh, okay. Anyhow.
So, fingers crossed.
Yeah, yeah. But my kids are sort of like listening to all of this. And in their mind, they're like, oh, we're getting a bitch. We're getting a lady dog. We're getting a lady dog. This one's yes. taken. That one yes. isn't. And then suddenly this one is scooped and they're snuggling it and they're like bathing in the puppy, all of that, right? I'm like, oh, shit.
Oh, yeah. They're getting attached to it immediately.
Immediately, yeah. So yes. we get out and like we're driving home and Lisa's like, you're a bit standoffish in there. You're a bit cold. And I was like, well, you know, like, we're probably not going to get one of those dogs, you know, like, you know. And she's like, no. And I'm like, well, no, I don't think so. And I was like, you know, you don't want to go in guns a-blazing when you have to sort of, like, do your due diligence. Stand on the sidelines, you know. You've got to get a feel for these yeah. things,
look
right?
at all your options, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Right? And we get home, and I can't exactly remember what happened, but it was the question was asked. So are we, you know, the kids? So we yeah. get, well, actually, I'm not sure even if the question was asked. I think it was more of a statement. It was like, so when are we picking her up?
Yeah.
And I'm like, which one? And Winter's like, the little one. The one with the little bitch with the nose. Yeah, the little bitch with the squash nose. And I was like, well, I'm not sure that we should get that one. And she's like, but that's the one, the only one, that's the only girl in that, the one, the litter that's available. I'm like, well, right. maybe we shouldn't get one from that litter. And maybe not her. Anyway, it just,
oh, dude.
She falls to bits. She just falls to bits in front of me. And,
yes.
And she's crying and she is, and I mean it, like, when I mean that this isn't sort of like 8-year-old crying, sort of like, I can't get my way. This is 8-year-old who her best friend in the world was George, our dog that we lost just over a year. It was her best friend. They were like glued together. They just wandered around the house together all the time. Wherever she was, he was there with her. And she lost him. And that's had like a big effect on her.
Yes.
And she's wanting a dog. So this was her. She was like, oh, like emotionally, I'm just sort of obviously reading between the lines here. I was like, I think that she was like, oh, I'm going to fill this hole, this emotional black hole in my heart.
Yes.
This little girl, this little like bat, you know, is going to solve
plug
this.
Plug the hole.
And I was the parent that was saying no. So she just fell to bits. Anyway,
oh, broken hearted Winter.
Long story short, we pick up the dog 2 days after Christmas. We're getting the dog.
Dude, a boxer on Boxing Day.
No,
baby.
No, but not Boston Terrier. Boston Terrier.
Oh,
so,
that's right. Sorry. Boston Terrier.
Yeah, a Boston Terrier. And the way that I kind of just. And I honestly, like, and I was waking up in that. And it was cool because all that to say. And there was a whole thing. I called the breeder. I was like, look.
I was like, look.
Are you sure there's nothing wrong with that dog? I said, my exact words were, I need to have a candid conversation with you. Anyway,
I love it so much.
Get in the dog, and the way that I sort of like justified this all in my mind was, that little dog is going to be going to somebody. We love dogs in our house, so it might as well be us. That's going to love that little ugly thing. We are going to accept it into our household, and we are going to love that thing like it's never been loved before.
Dude, and look, yeah, it's going to be awesome. You're a sweet guy. You're a good dad. I mean, you know, like, and you'll probably, hopefully you'll grow to love that horrible, ugly little bat dog.
I think it's those my, you know what? I was looking at, oh, I even told you the other day, didn't I? Like, I'm there at the time. Sorry. I'm so sorry. There's some people that would be hating on me right now. I know it.
Yeah. But yeah.
I am in the place. I'm in the room, and like, I'm looking around. I'm looking at the mom. I'm like, is she ugly?
the mom dog.
Yeah, the
got
loaf.
It. Yeah.
The loaf. Yeah.
The loaf, dude.
She's like a loaf.
She's like a little loaf with a bat face. And I thought, I'm going to take a picture of as evidence so I can show this. My kids afterwards. And
how
like,
ugly this dog is.
Look how ugly this dog is. We can't get one of these.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And I took a picture, and goddamn, she looks gorgeously cute on it. Look at her. Look at her.
Oh, let me see.
How cute does she look?
Oh, that's a cute dog, man.
Exactly,
that's the mom.
But even Stormy looked at that, and he was like, oh, she doesn't look like that. And in my mind, I was like, I know she doesn't look like that. That's why I took the photo as evidence. Anyway, so
a photogenic dog.
Yeah, I was having sort of like anxiety about it. I was like, I couldn't sleep. I was waking up in the morning. I talked it through. All I needed to do, interestingly, I talked it through with Lisa, and then it all went away. And I felt great about it. So I just needed to offload it. I needed to offload it onto Lisa and be like, look, are you sure we need to be bringing this little thing into our lives? And we've made peace with it, and I'm sure she's going to be awesome. Do you want to see her?
Of course, yes.
Want to see her? She's
of course.
Cute. Do you want to see? Oh, my God, she's so cute. Look at her!
Oh, come on, dude. That is outrageous. You had me thinking this was going to be a horribly ugly dog. That's a cute dog, man.
She's gorgeous, but she's a bit... look, in the flesh, she's a little weird looking.
Well, hey, aren't all babies a little weird looking in the flesh, you know? Baby, no matter what. Baby, you pick the animal. They're all a little weird looking.
Oh,
dude, I cannot wait. I cannot wait for that puppy to pee all over your house, chew on a bass.
Dude, I'm ready for it. I'm ready for the pee. Let me tell you, one night I got back from a gig with Lisa.
Yeah.
We had a dog called Frankie at the time. Frankie used to sleep on our bed. Anyway, we got back, and it was like cold. It was like in the winter. So we got back. We were in bed. I can remember, it was like, you know what the vibe is. You know when you get back from a gig and you're like almost like deliriously tired.
Yes.
And I can remember just sort of like chucking my clothes off onto the floor. And like getting into bed, I'm like in bed, and it was like really cold in December. And you know, like when you sleep, you put your hand, your face, you're like lying on your belly, and you put your head on the pillow, and you slide your hands under the pillow, right?
Okay,
so face on top of the pillow, hands under. And I'm like lying on the pillow, and it's really cold. I'm like,
oh, dude,
I'm like,
no.
Rubbing my hands on the pillow, like
no.
rubbing my face on the pillow. I'm like,
no.
My pillow's freezing. And like Lisa's like, my pillow's freezing as well. I was like, so cold. And then I'm like rubbing it more, and I'm like, is it wet? Is your pillow wet? And I'm like, and then suddenly I'm like,
oh.
I'm like, this is dog piss.
Oh my God.
And I'd been,
dude, that is my nightmare.
I'd been like nuzzling my face into
God. No. Gross. Oh.
Yeah.
Dude.
So Frankie had
she'd
peed all over the pillows. All over the pillows. And and I'd been nuzzling into it. Like snuggling down into it. Like, really cold. Anyway,
God.
Oh my God.
The joys.
20 minutes.
The joys.
Of
pet ownership.
Yeah, I'm sorry, everybody, if you didn't want 20 minutes of...
I'm not sorry.
Yeah, I know.
Not sorry at all.
But today, we thought it would be fun to talk about jazz. Yeah, jazz.
Hey, because that's swinging.
Yeah, it's swinging. Because we've got the Jazz Accelerator, which is a program that I did. I created it a couple of years ago. It's a badass program. We open it for enrollment once a year. We'll tell you a little bit about it today. But what we also wanted to jump into is just talking about our own experiences with jazz. Because, both of us have experiences with jazz, and a lot of other musicians do have experiences with jazz. And I think that just to sort of, I say it at the top of the conversation, you might be thinking, jazz, and imagine this kind of like, I don't know, if somebody said jazz to me a few years back, let's say I'm going to, by the way, I just pulled up my phone and YouTube's on it. Like everybody's reviewing the Cybertruck. Dude.
Oh, yeah.
Dude.
Like, yeah.
Like Blade Runner's happening before our eyes.
I know. Oh, like, I mean, that, this could turn into a... could go in that direction real fast, Divine. You better be careful. I thought we were talking about jazz.
But but yeah, like I don't think they're going to make it to the UK because we've got of our safety laws and stuff like that. Like, let's just put it out there. If one of those Cybertrucks hits you, it's going to kill you. It's
they're gonna monsters.
Like mash your body to bits. So I don't think we're going to have it in the UK. Because all Europe, actually, I think it's out. But because you Yanks just don't give two shits about people, you're just like, whatever,
bring it on, yeah, America, man. Hey, I got to have my truck.
Yeah.
It's
like,
weird.
It might kill some people, but, look at it. It's worth it.
Dude, it's a very strange entry into the truck market. I mean, the crazy thing is it does not appeal to, rural America. Like, it's an affront to what rural America values, like in truck aesthetic, which makes it so odd. There's never been anything like it. I was actually, dude, real quick Cybertruck tangent. I was talking to Rhett Schull about it because he posted a thing, someone really disparaging the Cybertruck. And to me, the Cybertruck has always just been fictional. I've thought that probably won't make it to market. What a crazy thing. And then it seems like it is going to make it to market, right? And I didn't put a deposit down, but dude, would I drive one of those? Yeah.
Yeah, are you kidding me? Dude.
Blade Runner come to life, just like you said. It looks like
it'll
a spinner.
Be amazing.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
And Rhett was like, I'm a huge car guy and I hate this truck. It's irresponsible. It's poorly designed. Its door latching system is crap. Its crash impact zones are terrible. There's so many reasons why this is a bad vehicle. It's unsafe. It's terrible.
Put a deposit down, right?
No.
It'd be so great.
He was texting me all. Yeah, and then he was like, "And I bought one." Yeah. He should.
He
listed this whole thing, and I said, "I get it. I do not care." And I was like, I don't know, man. I think I want one, and if that means our cyber friendship is over, that's. And then he was like, "You should get one, and drive it out, and let's make some videos." He's like, I hate it. And if you love it, let's do it.
I love it because it's so freaking bold.
It's crazy.
I love it because it's, I can't even put into words how freaking cool it is. I don't care what it looks like almost. I'm like, are you kidding me? It's like,
I know.
Elon had this idea, whatever he was, and people must have seen that in the company and just thought, are you freaking out of your mind?
I know.
And he's like, we're making it. it's amazing. I think it's actually maybe one of the greatest marketing campaigns ever. And I don't mean
it's unreal.
I don't mean the marketing campaign for Tesla. The Cybertruck. I mean the marketing campaign for Tesla as a company. Because now everybody, the whole world is talking about Tesla. And
yeah,
that
love
truck.
It or hate it. That's so true.
For me.
I saw a video too with the guys, the design team, or the two head of design for Tesla, who talked about how Elon, someone drew Elon something And then they did like a model of it in wood. They essentially did like a full size scale model in wood. And he walked in and he said, that's what we're building. And then he said, I want a prototype in 90 days. And they went, you know, I mean, just the, like the trials and tribulations of how that thing came to be, whether it's a huge success or a horrible failure, it is fascinating. And people will always remember, like, I mean, I remember where I was when I saw, like, you know, him. He also threw that like rock at the window. Remember that? Like,
dude, yeah.
And it broke. They're supposed to be shatterproof or whatever, bulletproof or whatever. And he threw something really heavy at it and it broke. He was like, oh shit. I mean,
I heard this, the wacky, let me tell you the story about Elon Musk. Yes. It's the wackiest story. He's just bought Twitter and there he wants to scale back the servers or something along those lines. He basically wants to scale back the servers and he's told, no, we can't do it. And he's mid-air in the plane flying somewhere. And I can't remember exactly, but it basically, he diverts the plane. He's like, actually, take me to the servers now. We're going to divert the plane and we're going to go to the servers ourselves, because he was trying to get this thing done and they wouldn't do it. So he diverts the plane, they land, and then they get to wherever the servers are, right?
Crazy.
And then he gets into the building and they're under some kind of flooring or something like that, or inside something. They can't get in. So he ends up like going and getting a freaking like a massive big piece of metal to basically break in and cut these freaking wires, dude. It's a he's like,
yeah. Say what you want about Mr. Musk, but yeah, he's a character.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Anyway, dude, let's do jazz. Let's do jazz. So somebody said to me, hey, what's jazz? I would, in my mind, imagine it's something like this. Let me just YouTube ads to get out of the way.
What's jazz? Hey, if someone were to say, hey, man, what do you think of when you think of jazz? Yes. So you think bebop.
Well, I don't, but I would have. You know, if somebody said, jazz, I would have just thought, oh, yeah, you know.
Up-tempo swing, horn head.
Exactly. Yes. Lots of horns, playing stuff that I don't really understand, doesn't sound very melodic to me at the time.
Right.
When I listen to the bass, it sounds like an old guy singing the shower.
Yes.
Like that thing, right? That's what I thought jazz was when I was younger.
Right.
And the reason why I wanted to show an example of it is because it's not that. So if anybody thought, oh, jazz, and thought that isn't jazz. When we say jazz, it's actually, jazz is improvised music. It's music that has a real strong or a big element of improvisation within it. Now, somebody could say, well, what about blues? Well, jazz is actually derived directly from blues, and blues is, for the most part, around a very specific chord sequence, right? 1-4-5 or is derived. There's variations of it, but it's often a 1-4-5 sort of like chord. And
typically, like 12-bar format as well.
Exactly.
Right. The form.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Whereas jazz doesn't have to be that. So when somebody says jazz to me, it could be modern jazz. It could be, you know, fusion jazz. It could be sort of like, you know, that sort of like Chris Dave kind of, you know, kind
with
of.
With Pino at the Blue Note.
Yeah, exactly. Like that's jazz for me. So it's very, there's lots of different variations of jazz. And the thread that, you know, the thing that joins them all together, that thread is improvisation. And all that to say, I think that a really interesting aspect or thing about jazz is that for the most part, all of the greatest bass players that you'll be able to name, let's just sort of like throw some out there right now. So, like Nathan East, Victor Wooten, Jaco Pastorius.
Yeah, Stanley Clark,
James Jameson, Carole Kaye.
Carole Kaye. Oh, jinx.
Lee Sklar. Oh man, there's
Michelle and Deggio Cello.
Yes, like huge list, right? Of these sort of like the bass players. You know, the cream of the crop. For the most part, all of them have studied jazz at one moment in time or throughout their entire careers. Even if a lot of the names that we have mentioned there haven't actually played jazz as part of their career. So some of them have, and they've been involved in jazz. Like a great example of that would be Anthony Jackson. He's done some really fantastic jazz projects.
Like Lee Ritner, Michael League too.
Yeah, Michael League from Snarky Puppy. Exactly, like huge sort of like jazz influence in his playing.
Yes.
And although that a lot of these characters haven't actually, or some of them haven't been, you know, done sort of like jazz from like a commercial standpoint and had their careers sort of like wrapped around that, they have studied it in depth in their past, but also, you know, some of them have done a lot of jazz stuff as well. So it's just an interesting thing. And you might be thinking, why? Like, why have all of these people studied jazz to some extent? So, which is why we wanted to talk about it today and talk about our journeys with jazz and how we got into it. So you go first, man. Like, when did you realize, or when did the word jazz even become like of interest to you?
Man, all right. I had a stepfather who, my stepdad, Dave, who loved jazz. And I remember thinking it was sort of like old guy music, right? Mm. And so I was like, yeah, but they would take me to see, they took me, my mom and my stepdad used to take me to this thing in Moscow, Idaho, that was like a jazz festival. And I saw some really amazing stuff there. I didn't appreciate it in real time, but it did make an impact on me. Mm. But I will say my first experience with jazz for real is I wanted to play bass in jazz band. I wanted to play electric bass in jazz band. Yeah. I was in the eighth grade, and I will never forget getting into jazz band, and my first bass teacher told me that I could only play with a pick. So I came up as a bass player only playing with a pick. I couldn't read music. They throw me into jazz band, and I knew how to play the you know, a triad shape. Here, I'll plug it in. And I will never forget, like, you know, they called C-Jam Blues in jazz band.
C-Jam Blues.
C-Jam Blues, dude. And I played with a sound like this, and I played like this. I essentially played blues, which is what my, you know, teacher showed me, with that sound picked by the bridge. Sounds like, you know, like if like Chris Squire were playing blues or something. And it was so bad. But I thought that's how you did it. And then the teacher was like, hold on, what are you doing? And I was like, I'm playing C-Jam Blues. He's like, what are you playing with? And I'm like, a pick. And then the whole classroom laughed at me. They laughed.
No.
Plays with a pick. And then he was like, can we go down to this part of the tune? And I couldn't read music. He's like, you're not playing the bass line, what's written there. You know, and I was like, oh, I don't know how to read music. And he was like, you don't know how to read music. And everyone laughed, dude. And I came out of that class thinking, jazz is the worst, you know? Like, I was like, this is horrible. I will never, ever, I don't want to do this. You know, my mom took me to Dairy Queen, you know, like an ice cream place, right? Yeah. And, you know, sort of like there as I like, you know, ate ice cream and cried into my sundae, you know? But I went back and I learned a lot, but that was my first experience with it. It was like something my stepdad really liked. It was like old people shit. And then the old mean teacher laughed at me. It was this exclusive club that I was not a part of, you know? Yeah. I didn't have a good guru. I didn't have a good teacher saying to me, hey, you know, this is amazing. You just need to learn a few things so that you can hear this better. That's the negative. I will say then the positive experience for me, my parents kept taking me to these jazz festivals. The great Brian Bromberg was at one of them. And my mom actually booked me a lesson with Brian that I took in his hotel room in, I mean, I was probably 14 or 15, and he was so nice to me. He spent a lot of time with me, and I wanted to learn how he went, you know. I wanted to learn. He does all this crazy tapping stuff.
Yeah.
And then he showed me, well, you know, that's actually derived from, you know, these chord shapes, these sort of seven chord shapes. And do you know any of that stuff? And I was like, oh, here we go. You know, jazz. Great. Because I just wanted to be like, I just wanted to shred. And he was like, well, it's all, you know, when I'm playing a G down here and I'm playing this note up here, that's the third of G, or, you know, and I remember thinking, oh, this matters. And he told me in like a really kind way, and he said nice things about my playing. He's like, I can tell you have, you know, whatever, natural talent. You know, he was nice to me. And he said, if you studied with me, this is what we'd work on. And he showed me essentially all the way through, you know, like diatonic tenths, right? And then putting sevens in them, right? This kind of thing. The dominant, minor, flat five, you know. And that whole thing was fascinating to me. And it started me on this journey of like, wow, I wasn't hearing that harmony before. Yeah. And it started me on this journey. I like got into the modes on my own and got really excited about that. I started to play some gigs with people that were more versed in jazz. So I got the Omni book by Parker.
Yeah, dude,
I started
to
teach at a college, right? And there was a jazz program there. So I like really dove in, like tried to get my walking together, tried to read a bunch of heads, learned Donna Lee, got into Jocko. But I was late. I was late to it because I think I had sort of traumatic, you know, like teenage experience with it.
Yeah.
And I have always held it at a bit of a distance, I must say. It's a music to me, the broad term, like I'm never seeking out traditional jazz. Like when you played, you know, Parker Ornithology here, like that, I'm never seeking that out to listen to, you know?
Yeah.
So for me, jazz has always been more of like a cerebral thing. But am I so thrilled that I learned the shapes, learned the triads, learned the inversions, learned how to use chord tones to build bass lines in other genres and styles and for session work? Yes. Without it, dude, without jazz, I think that I am just this.
Yeah, you know, it's really, it's so interesting, isn't it? Like Sean Hurley said exactly the same thing. I had a conversation with Sean Hurley, not our conversation that we were talking about with him the other day, but it was actually a few years ago. And he said that jazz was the gateway for him to understanding music. He was like, without like learning how jazz, it's not really how jazz works. It's that, let me put it this way. He didn't put it this way, but I'm going to sort of like, I guess sort of do a, I'll paraphrase it for him. It's like jazz is like a really fantastic vehicle or tool to learning how music works.
Yep.
In fact, I would argue it's maybe the best. It's like the best tool to help you understand how music works, how all of the chords are connected, how key centers work, how melodies work, how modes work.
Yes.
It's like how to build bass lines. Like it all comes from jazz. It's like it's this perfect thing that was created specifically for teaching people the tools to go and do all of them things. So if you want to create your own bass lines, if you want to play chords, if you want to understand music in a deeper way and understand how all the chords link together, if you want to play solos, if you want to do sort of like steaming big bass riffs, I mean, bass runs and licks and stuff like that, jazz is like, oh, it's just this beautiful thing that was created to help you do that. And without... Like, I think it's fair to say that you wouldn't be able to play like you do now if you hadn't gone through that experience learning those jazz tunes, right?
For sure. I was rock dude. You know, I was playing in a rock band with a pick. And I think going in, really diving in, like learning Donna Lee, learning Teen Town, learning how, like, slowing down Donna Lee and understanding, like, oh, hearing, like, hearing those chord shapes of, like, a major seven chord to a six dominant chord, that motion, just that, was such an odd sound to my ear. That's atop of Donna Lee, right? And, like, just hearing that, slowing it down and understanding, you know, you know, like hearing a melody.
Yeah.
Hearing that seven over the, my brain was just so used to diatonic, you know, pop melodies.
Yeah.
And so for me, it really took, teaching the stuff. So I was in an environment where I had to teach.
You had to learn kids. It to teach it, didn't you?
Yeah. So I'm scrambling. I mean, oh, so sorry to any of my students that, you know, that might listen to this and be like, hold on, were you just like a week ahead of me in learning?
Yes. That's what my dad always used to tell me. He was like, yeah, you just got to be a week or two ahead of your students and you'll be fine.
Yeah, that's right. Oh my God. But I mean, you know, I remember someone's coming to me and saying, I have to learn Donna Lee for jazz. And I was like, well, you know, I know what my next week looks like, but it was so good for me. And what I had to do is I had to slow it down and sing the melodies. I had to hear the melodies, how they interacted over the chords to understand it. And what, you know, when I first heard Jaco play Donna Lee, the first track on his solo record, to me, it sounded like noise. It sounded like bullshit, actually.
Yeah.
It was terrible to me. And it was because I wasn't steeped in the language. I couldn't hear. There were no chords. I mean, that was an obtuse arrangement, man. Like, just the head over, like, congas. I mean, that is wild. And it's so cool now. But when, you know, my bass teacher showed it to me, I thought he was high, you know, and in the worst way. I was like, this is terrible. So, you know, for me, it just took a long time of slowing things down and hearing how the chords interacted with the melodies to make it feel beautiful to me, you know?
Yeah. I can remember the first time, do you know that Jaco video with John Scofield and Ken Wood-Denham playing on the end? I can remember like listening to that. Dude, I was like listening to Steve Vai at the time in Satriani, and I can remember listening to that at the end and I was like, who is this guitar player? He's who's this John Scofield muppet? Did they pull him off the street because they couldn't get a good guitar player
because they couldn't get Slash?
Yeah. It was like and obviously like John Scofield's a freaking monster. And now I listen to it. It's interesting actually listening to Jaco play now, because I did appreciate the first time I was older when I heard that video, when I watched that video for the first time, the Jaco Pastorius Modern Electric Bass video, which is on YouTube if anybody wants to check it out.
It's amazing.
I can remember watching that, and it was a little just angular. My ears couldn't make head and tail of it. But I could appreciate the bass playing on the end of it. But now when I watch it, I'm like, oh wow, it was incredible what he was doing, and obviously John Scofield as well. But Jaco is, I think Jaco was my, I was working, so I was like rock dude, same as you when I was a kid, and I started working at Overwater Basses. And Chris was playing this music that I'd never heard before. And I was like, oh, what is this? And he was like, oh, this is Brand X. This is Percy Jones on bass, Phil Collins on drums. It's fusion. It's jazz. I was like, that's jazz? And he's like, yeah, it's jazz. And then he was like, oh, and he like, you know, gave me this weather report tape with Jaco Pastorius, Joe Zawinul, you know, Wayne Short. I was like listening to that. I can remember listening to Havona and being like,
yeah,
what? And he was like, right, that's jazz, right? Shall I play Havona quickly for anybody that hasn't heard it?
Yes, please. Man, I wish I had somebody like that, like Chris, in my life at that time. I came to all this stuff way late.
Yeah.
Too late.
Oh, another ad. Sorry, everybody. Who puts these ads on YouTube, eh?
Seriously.
Like, somebody might have watched an ad from me yesterday. Yeah. They were like, screw you, Divine.
Of course, yes.
With these ads.
Oh, yeah.
Hang on. So it's just coming up now. Bear with me, people. This is worth it. Okay. So I can remember Chris playing me this for the first time.
Oh yeah. Like synthesizers were so...
It's new, wasn't it? When was it recorded?
70s?
77. We weren't even born.
That's right.
And then... Like one of my favorite bass lines.
Just, it's so cool.
It's outrageous, isn't it?
It is cool.
And Chris was like, oh, that's jazz. And I was like, oh, and that sent me down this sort of like pathway of like, oh, I need to get into jazz because this sounds cool. Now, it's interesting because at some point, some dude was like, oh, you should listen to Charlie Parker. I was like, oh, yeah, okay. I'd never heard of Charlie Parker. I can remember listening to Charlie Parker just thinking, this sucks. This does not sound like Weather Report. You know?
Right. Because you were into that cool, new, modern jazz. I mean, you know,
exactly.
Right? When Fusion was coming out, it was so trendsetting and so hip and, you know, like and it was in the late 70s.
Yeah, in the late 70s. And then I got into all of the sort of like John Patitucci stuff, and that was very fusion-y. And like, you know, like listening to Frank Gambale on guitar, Vital Information, you know, all of that stuff, which is kind of very rocky. But that was my, I guess, sort of like entrance into jazz, the world of jazz. And then I did listen to, I heard about people like Charlie Parker, like, you know, and then I did go on to listen to people like extensively, like Miles Davis and John Coltrane and Cannonball Adderley, and like I did get into a lot of the more traditional sort of like, you know, Miles Davis and his quintet and stuff like that.
Yes.
But for me it was like it was the fusionier stuff that got me into it. And the interesting stuff about the fusionier stuff is that for me it didn't really it sounded great, but it wasn't very accessible. Now I did learn some of the lines, but even though it was jazz and I was like, didn't give me what I needed to actually be a better musician. I was a better technician off the back of it, but I couldn't really play music better. It didn't give me enough about understanding how music worked yet until I was actually working professionally on the ships, like 3-4 years after that. After, you know, discovering Weather Report and all of them bands, I was working on a ship and we had to do this jazz set, and mother of God, I could not play for the life of me. I had to do walking bass lines and I couldn't play it. And there was this dude who came on as a passenger, and in the daytimes, his wife and friends would go off and they'd wander around, you know, do the whole sort of like touristy thing. And this guy, well, he wouldn't. He would leave his wife to go do the thing, and he would stay on board and practice. He would shed on the piano. And I got speaking with this guy, and he was like, he'd obviously heard me play, and he could hear that I was struggling. Turns out this guy was a lecturer, I think, at Juilliard. And I think it was Juilliard.
Crazy.
Yeah. And he was like, listen, he was like, what standards do you really know? And I was like, well, you know, I know the ones that I've been playing. And he was like, Do you really know them? He's like, do you know the melody? Like,
do you?
And he just sat me down, and he was like, look, there's 7 chords in a key. And he sat down with these jazz standards that I was playing. And dude, he just sort of like revealed this world to me that I didn't even know existed. It was the red pill, blue pill vibe right in the Matrix. Yep. He was like, look, I can give you this pill. You take this, and it's going to change your reality of how you listen to music, how you understand music. And he just sat me down and with a few jazz standards, took me through. And my life was never it was like, do you know one of them moments in time? Sometimes it's something somebody says. Sometimes it's something somebody shows you. But like after that moment, life's never the same. It was one of those. It was one of those moments. Yeah. And for me, that's what jazz is. When I say that jazz is such an amazing tool to learn this just like music in a deeper way, that's where it came from. That realization when I sat down with, I think his name was Dave, when I sat down with him for that week, and we used to meet every day. God, man, I was so
that's
gutted.
Incredible.
Dude, So spending a week with that guy, just an hour a day, changed the complete trajectory of my life. Because
wow,
after that, I went and bought a real book. I bought a real book after, which is a book of jazz suits. I bought it the week after he left. I can remember sitting with my friend who was playing keys at the time on the ship. We were sitting in Italy somewhere at a cafe. I had this brand new real book that I just bought. And I was talking to Tim, and we were kind of just sort of like, wow, isn't this amazing? Because we kind of just like discovered it together. He was talking to Tim as well. And I remember saying to Tim, you know what, when I get off the ship, I'm going to go study this stuff. I'm going to find somebody to teach me like how to play jazz standards and do this whole thing. So it was this whole kind of just, it was like I discovered the Matrix. And that's when I'm talking to music students, when I'm talking about jazz, that's why I try and really sell them on it. I'm like, look, you've got this opportunity, and it's really fun to get into this stuff. It isn't boom, 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 boom. It isn't the old guy singing in the shower. It's actually
right. This
whole new world. And when you get into it, you're never going to be able to listen you're never going to be able to listen or play music in the same way again. And it's going to impact your bass playing more than anything that you've probably ever done in the past. Like, you've learned some cool riffs, you've learned some grooves, but this, like, learning jazz is going to completely revolutionize how you actually play the bass.
Yep. And it's that it comes back to the thing that you said, the thread that connects jazz. Like, if you're thinking, what is jazz? And is it this? Ding, 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 or is it fusion? Or what, or is it Stevie Wonder? What is it? Well, it's improvised music with a certain set of harmony. I think that's something you've said before, too. It's like you can improvise, you can jam it with a rock band, because jam band music, like what Fish does, is different than jazz. Because I think the quality of the chords or the harmony that's used, right, in jazz sort of separates it maybe from a jam band scenario. Or like I do improvised sets with a band where someone is on samples, but there's not a lot of seven chord material. It's more almost like pop improv, and we wouldn't call it jazz, So I think chord quality is a big deal. But dude, I wanted to just do this. This was illuminated to me a long time ago, and I just think like, okay, so bear with me. So check it out. So you've got, if you learn how to walk a bass line, like Scott's talking about, right? Obviously you can play jazz, right? You're walking a bass line, right? But you can take that same shape, right? So I just played an A minor 7 chord. And, Scott, tell me, just give me a different genre.
Reggae.
So if I wanted to play a reggae bass line, that's the same frickin' information. Minor 7 chord. Now here's the walk.
Funk.
Oh, yeah. Right?
Rock.
Funk. Rock.
Like Foo Fighters rock.
Okay, here we go.
Same, isn't it?
It's all the same notes. So but you won't learn that stuff. You won't learn the breakdown of what an A minor 7 chord is outside of jazz. It comes from jazz, right? So, and that happens on every single chord quality. So the reason that learning how to walk and learning how to play a jazz standard is so important is because it is literally the blueprint for understanding those chord tones. If you walk a standard like Autumn Leaves and you just walk the chord tones, that's all that information right under your fingers. So you can take those chords and play them and play a jazz standard. And then you're like, oh, those are the building blocks of all of the arpeggios and the chord tones. I've spelled them out through these jazz standards. And then you can take that and play bossa nova, funk, rock, metal, swing, or like ska. reggae, it's country, it's crazy.
Which is why when we were talking at the beginning of this podcast, we were saying all of these legendary bass players have all studied jazz.
Yes.
Even though a lot of them haven't, you know, been involved in jazz from a professional standpoint, they've all studied it. That's why, right? Because they can get all of that information and they can use it in whatever genre of music or style of music they're playing.
Yes.
In. It's applicable. It's all applicable.
Yes.
Yeah. Bonkers.
Exactly, yeah. Right. And that was a powerful thing for me to understand, because I was one of those guys, Scott. I was one of the people saying, well, I'm not going to take a jazz course because I don't need to, you know, I don't want to play that kind of music. I'm a pop guy. I'm a rock guy. I'm a hip hop guy. But I didn't understand early on, like in my late teens, 20s, that, oh, by learning that stuff, that was what was going to give me the skills to even create bass lines way outside of improvised music. I mean, so, you know, yes, improvising, okay, but what if you're in a band and the guitar player is going, playing A, an A chord, and you don't want to just go, right?
Yeah.
Well, you know what? What if you play... is just an A minor 7 chord in a rock context. Yeah. And if you don't know that stuff, you will be limited, like severely limited in your creativity, in your improvability. You'll be absolutely hamstrung by not knowing that stuff. So it's freaking critical, dude.
It is.
Don't you agree?
No, it's like it is. It is. And if you go to any bass teacher in the, like a real life bass player teacher in the flesh, they will teach you this stuff. Like if they're worth their salt, they will. It'll just be like baked in. Like that's the stuff that you're
part of what you need to do.
It's
that's
baked
right.
in. Like the whole number system, like 251s, all of that stuff. Like. That are used in studios around the world and have been for years.
Yeah.
It's all based on jazz.
That's right.
You know, it's the perfect tool to learn music in a way that levels you up to where you're kind of like operating as a proper musician, not like a paint by numbers.
Yes.
I'm just going to copy what this person did on this song and I'm just going to regurgitate the same thing. Right. It's like, there's that. If you want to, just do that, great. Okay, if you just want to regurgitate what other people have done, or just, you know, and that's cool, some people just want to do that, or kind of like hammer along on roots and fives, great. But if you do want to become like a real functioning musician, it's kind of just, it's like a you have to do it. I will just mention I'll just mention it now. If you do want to check out the Jazz Accelerator, which is why we thought we wanted to do this podcast, because we only open the Jazz Accelerator once a year for enrollment. And right now is, in fact, I think it's been enrollment for, we normally open enrollment, I think for 10 days. It's been a bunch. I think that Lydia said, shout out to Lydia. Hey, Lydia. Lydia said that
Lydia?
We were going to publish towards the end of the enrollment. So depending on when you're listening to this, please go check it out sooner rather than later if you want to check it out, because I would hate for you to miss it this year. I have to wait till next year. Oh, actually, wait a minute. I don't think it's happening next year, right? Yeah, it's going to be a sort of like a, we're converting it into a coaching program, which is going to be a couple of grand, I think. So, let me say this then.
I think you're right.
No, it is. Yeah, it's getting converted into a coaching program, isn't it, with coaches and stuff. Okay, this might be the last time. I think that this is the last time it's going to be available. So if you do want to check it out, just go to studybasewithscott.com and it's available there. It's a 15 week or 16. I think it's a 15 week program. It lasts 15 weeks or maybe 16, one of the two. And it's based around three jazz standards. And what we do, it's like three modules, and each jazz standard, we take a jazz standard and we work on that jazz standard. And a jazz standard is just a jazz song, right? So we take a jazz standard and we take that jazz standard, and then we learn various things over that jazz standard. We basically use that jazz standard as like a tool to learn these different things on, right? So to begin we learn how to play walking bass lines around that first jazz standard. And we start out pretty easy, okay? So first of all, walking bass lines. We then learn the melody of that jazz standard. So you're learning to actually play a melody, because if you've ever had any aspirations of playing a solo, which is basically a melody that you just come up with on the spot, right? Improvising a solo, you first of all need to be able to play the melody, right? So we learn how to play the melody.
Yes, that's right.
We then learn how to play all of the chords, like actual, like playing the chords.
Actual chords. Yeah,
playing the chords of the entire piece. And then we also do a full harmonic analysis, so you understand where, like, why these chords work, where they all fit within the sort of like tonal key centers. We talk about all of that stuff that really will turn you into a real sort of like, you know, function musician rather than sort of like a, just a sort of like roots bass player, you know, like a function bass, function musician. And then finally, we look at how to solo improvise over that jazz standard. Okay. So that happens on one jazz standard. So we do, in each week, we spend time looking into each individual sort of like skill. So walking bass lines on 1 week, soloing on another week, the harmonic analysis on another week, playing the chords on another week. You get the point? So each week is spent doing a different skill or topic over that one jazz standard. And now when we've rinsed that jazz standard out, if we've spent 5 weeks on that jazz standard, we then do the same thing on the next jazz standard. Then we do a whole 5 weeks on that jazz standard, and then we do the whole thing, and then we get another jazz standard, and then do the next whole block of 5 weeks on that next jazz standard. So basically, we're taking three jazz standards and using a really specific framework where you learn the walking bass line, you learn the melody, you learn how to improvise, you learn how to play chords, you learn how to the harmonic analysis, that whole thing over each of the jazz standards. And by the end of the program, you will know these standards inside out. You'll know the melody, you'll know the chords, you'll know how to play a walking bass line. And by doing that, the standards that we've picked are really specific for the tools and techniques that we're going to be teaching you. So that was the sort of like how I put it together over the that's how I put it together over those jazz standards, and why we put this course together, to be able to give you a course that really gives you a systematic way to learn jazz.
And check this out too. It's not, if you're thinking, oh, okay, just three jazz standards, God, but there's so many. Check this out. The three jazz standards that are chosen are like so many styles of music that when you get in, you start to notice similarities.
Yeah,
like in rock music, you hear the similarity of this chord progression. 1, 5, 6, 4. Right?
Yeah.
You notice that throughout all different tunes, and you go, oh, wait, is this all kind of the same? Yeah. And yes, in a way, the structures are all the same. Well, jazz is no different. You see that reel book with 1,000 frickin' standards, and you're like, wait a minute, I have to memorize 1,000 different chord progressions? No. Actually, the ones that were chosen in the Jazz Accelerator give you the keys. Like, once you learn all the things you are, which I believe is one of the ones in the Jazz Accelerator, is that right?
I think so, yeah.
You go, I get it. That's just like 40% of these other jazz standards. Yeah. And you start to see the same shapes. You know, you hear about 2-5-1s. You see that stuff cropping up in almost every standard. And you go, oh, because you've poured yourself hard into three tunes, not focusing on, you know, breadth or width of like, you're gonna skim the surface and learn, you know, how to walk over 20 different tunes. No, you learn the whole thing, deep dive into three tunes. And then I guarantee, I don't know if I personally guarantee, I'll maybe throw that guarantee on SBL that when you open up to another standard, you're going to go, oh, you know what? This structure is very similar.
Yeah.
To that thing I did on the jazz accelerator. And you will then have the vocabulary, and it will be this thing of like, oh, I get it. This is just like any other genre where there's things that repeat, there's similar forms. And by doing the deep dive, you'll discover that. And it will allow you to play all the jazz standards.
Yeah, dude. And like, and just to put it out there as well, if somebody's thinking, yeah, great, but I can't do it now. Do you know what I mean? Like, I haven't got the money to enroll or whatever it is. Please, first of all, go do it on your own. Like, you've got to dig into some jazz. You've got to learn some jazz standards. You have to learn how to play walking bass lines. Okay, so I don't give two craps if you enroll in this course or not. Okay, great if you do. Okay, we've packaged it and sort of like, you know, I spent freaking months putting that curriculum together. It's badass.
Yeah.
We've got some absolutely phenomenal bonuses as well that we've thrown in. Again, if you want to check it out, just go to studybasewithscott.com, studybasewithscott.com. But if you can't, look, go do this stuff anyway. Please learn. There's so much.
Yes.
It's going to be so impactful for your bass playing, okay? And what Ian was saying is absolutely right. Instead of thinking to yourself, I am going to learn 20 jazz standards, that is not the move. The move is actually to get one standard and just focus on that for a month, maybe even longer.
Yes.
And then once, let's say 6 weeks, once you've done that, once you've learned the melody and the chords and how to play walking bass lines around it, and you've listened to other people play that jazz standard and soaked it in. Okay. Once you've done that, then move on to the next jazz standard and do rinse and repeat, do the same thing. It is so valuable. It's so impactful. Both of us would not be here if we hadn't done this kind of stuff ourselves.
Totally true. That's totally true. Yeah. And I use jazz every single day in my session playing, in my gigging life, even though I'm not playing swing music from the 40s, 50s, 60s and beyond. Yeah. I'm using the theory. I'm using the theory every single day when I'm writing bass lines, when I'm improvising. I mean, you know, Scott just would say genres and I could take that stuff and play something that sounded like that. That is because I have worked hard on getting that vocabulary into my hands of like, how can I make this shape work in different genres?
Exactly.
And it would not be the case if it weren't for jazz. So it's a big deal. It's a big deal.
So I've actually got a question for you, Ian. But before I get to the question, everybody, again, if you want to go check it out, go to studybasewithscott.com. This is the last time we will be open it for enrollment. We actually did. We did the last enrollment for it in June, I think, this year. And we didn't have it open for enrollment as long as we usually do. And we had a few of you were a little grumpy with us. Oh, you were a little grumpy.
That wanted to get in.
Yeah.
So we
opened it again one last time for enrollment. And this is it. And then again, next year, it's going to be converted into, we wanted to experiment and we're doing a coaching program where we're going to be using that curriculum, but have people like coaches involved with experience, so group coaching thing, but that's going to be a lot more expensive, like I think probably around a couple of grand or something like that. So this is the last time it's going to be
and
available.
What's this one? Is this one 197?
I think it's like 197. It's 197, and I think if you remember, you get a deal as well.
That's a bargain at twice the price, Divine.
It is ridiculous. We've had this conversation before. When Ian started when he joined the team here at SBL, he was like, these accelerators are too cheap.
I think they are. I mean, you know, I'm biased now, you know, right? Because I work at SBL, but I remember checking them out and thinking, oh, wait, this is way more value and way more information. Like, these should be double, triple, quadruple the amount of money, I think, for what you get. I mean, you know, whatever. It sounds like, hey, last time at this price, but that's true.
it's true.
It's the last time at this price. It will be converted to a coaching program, which might be incredible. Like, you know, if you need that in your life, that's, you know, you'll want to check that out. But if you want to get this information, you're a good self-starter, you're a good self-motivator, you want to dive into the info on your own time, Without coaching, this is the last time.
It certainly is. What's the URL again? Oh, studybasewithscott.com. Yeah.
Studybasewithscott.com, baby.
What I was going to say, dude, is what you've been listening to recently. Hit me with something. I've been kind of stuck. I want some cool new bands or like artists. Yeah.
What have I been listening to lately? Oh, God, you have to hit me with that, don't you? What have I been listening to lately? Let's just take, you know what? Thank God I've got Spotify right here. You know, I've been listening to Touch Sensitive a lot. That's the guy from New Zealand. The 36th Level record is amazing. I think
have we mentioned him on the pod before? We have, haven't we? Incredible. He's amazing.
I feel like we have. He is amazing.
Warwick Dolphin.
There's another record.
Is it a Warwick Dolphin?
Yeah, playing a Warwick
Dolphin.
Tell
you what I was looking at the other day.
He's an absolute.
When Lisa was sleeping.
What were you looking at?
Lisa was sleeping.
What?
I was like, pulled that phone out.
What was it?
freaking Warwick Streamers.
Yeah, you did.
Warwick Streamers, man. Yeah, I went through this. It was Warwick Streamers and the Spectre, is it the NS2? I was like looking at them. I was like, I have never played. I am desperate actually to play Spectre NS2 because I've just never played one.
Oh, you?
I was online. I was like looking at the NS2 versus the Warwick Streamer conversation because they look pretty much identical. I think it's an identical body shape.
They do.
And everybody's talking online about how they're different. And
they are a little different. Yeah. I mean, they, you know, the famous story is Warwick just took the curve. And I believe that, you know, didn't think like they were going to work something out with Spectre. Then they didn't. And they just did it anyway, because they knew that Mr. Stuart Spectre was too small to litigate. And I hold that against Warwick. I think that's a bummer. But that said, there's a lot of, I mean, streamers out there and a lot of great players that play them. And obviously, you know, Stuart Zender.
Dude,
I love
that's the
Dirk
thing
Lance
that sent me
with,
down the rabbit hole.
Incubus.
Like, that's what sent me down the rabbit hole. It was Zender. It was... We've just, like, Ian's just been over here hanging in the UK, and we did these videos, and one of them was, like, a Jamiroquai thing. We were, like, listening to Zender bass lines. So two things. What, and I feel guilty for both of them, and I do apologize, guys. You know, I'm sure that you've seen a video go out, and you've wondered, oh, why didn't they mention this? Or you thought that we've dropped the ball, and, oh, they should have mentioned that. Look, it happens. Like, we... like hammer through these videos and it's sometimes, let me just put it up there, a little grueling, you know, it's, you know, we're making the shoot that we just did we did 12 in a week. So it's a lot, and there's a lot of research and stuff like goes into the videos. Sometimes we miss something. Okay. Well, we missed a really great, but you know, we did the greatest five or greatest six Jamiroquai bass lines or something like that. We missed one out, dude. We missed one out, and people
are
going to crucify us for it. Mr. Moon. Mr. Moon. And as I say this, people are going to be like, somebody just spat out their coffee. Somebody was just like, you missed out that.
You missed that? Yeah.
Incredible. Let me just. Mr. Moon. Oh, you know what? Let me just check something. Before I go down that rabbit hole, let me just double check something.
The Jamiroquai baseline episode was so fun. I mean, we got to dig into all the stuff that I, you know, you're more of a Zender aficionado. I came to them late. You know, so I was on that, you know, who played Don't Give Hate a Chance? It wasn't Paul Turner. It was like Derek.
Oh, I can't remember.
What's his last name? Shoot. I shouldn't have even started this whole thing, but that whole like.
Yeah.
Like that whole thing.
So check this man. Out.
It was really.
That's an ad. So I'm feeling guilty about that. I've been listening to that, and that sent me down this whole sort of like, you know, Warwick Streamer thing. But also, but also, oh, I forgot to mention that when Zender was playing them, it was like really, they were, it was acid jazz. That's what they were playing.
Right. Oh.
Oh, God, damn. I know.
Yes, of course.
So good. So, I know. So good. Anyway, so I actually think that was a P bass on that record. But anyway, so it sounds great, so doesn't good. It? But we missed that. And then also, I forgot to mention, and it was, I don't know why, but when Zender was with them, they were playing acid jazz. That was the vibe.
Yeah.
And then as they progressed, they actually went into disco. It's much more sort of like funk disco. Right. So, and for me, when I listen to it, it's interesting. I really resonate with the older acid jazz stuff, where when I look online, there's actually more people seem to vibe with the funk disco stuff. Yeah, it's the interesting. Disco. Yeah,
right. That was my era it for sure. Yeah, you guys were over in the UK. You were just acid early
jazz,
adopters.
I don't think it was a huge thing in the UK, in the US, right? Acid jazz was
Maybe not as huge. Yeah, definitely like subculture subset, but yeah, I think it was a bigger like culturally.
Yeah,
I think
there
was
like Corduroy.
The UK,
there was like the brand new heavies, Jamiroquai.
Yeah,
James Taylor Quartet. Yep. There's like a lot. It was a cool movement. I really would love that to come back in some way, shape, or form. I reckon I would love to see the acid jazz come back. Anyway, dude, I'm gonna have to bounce. I've got a call that I am 13 minutes late to that I've just realized. I was like, so I'm gonna have to bounce. The internet's been a beast today, hasn't it? It keeps cutting out for me. Does it keep cutting out for you as well?
Yes,
oh, I hate it.
I know. Yes, it
anyway,
does.
Anyway, I know. We've just been going like this at some point. So I'm just going to keep... No, yeah. You've got it.
Yeah.
Anyway, dudes, thank you so much for hanging out today. Yeah. We love you. And we'll see you next time. See you in a bit. Bye.
Take care, everybody.